Hi guys, in today's session, we're going to discuss with you modern Indian history, the advent of Europeans. My name is Ranganathan SVN Kundla, and in this session of videos, I'm going to discuss with you some of the most important topics of modern Indian history, which will be very useful for your UPSC students as well as mates. You can follow me on my Unacademy channel. You can search me on Unacademy as Ranganathan SVN Kundla, as well as you can follow me on my Telegram channel. On Telegram, that is my Telegram link, UPSC GS1, for all kinds of important guidance. At the same time, you can follow me on onlineiascoaching.com as the website and on Facebook as Srivana. In today's session, we're going to discuss the advent of Europeans. See, the coming of Europeans was one of the most important activities which happened in the modern Indian history. In a series of periods, a series of Europeans actually came to the country. Of them, British East India Company had been the most successful. The arrival of Europeans. See, one of the earliest European contacts happened with India somewhere in the 15th century. India was very important for Europeans for a few things. Primarily, if you go by analyzing, India was very important for Europeans for cotton, for spices and trade. Europe, or between Europe and India, one of the most important connecting sections was the Central Asia, which we today call Constantinople or Istanbul. In Istanbul, whence Istanbul was lost to the Middle Eastern Arabic traders, the Christian communities of Europe felt it very difficult to access India through the land. So there was an aim to search sea route towards India. That aim to search for a sea route towards India is what led to the exploration of India. You can see this here. There were the Portugal, Spain were one of the first countries to actually try to search a sea route via African coast directly into India so that they don't have to depend on the Arabian communities. The Europeans who came to India in sequence primarily were Portuguese, who came first. They're also the last to leave the country. Dutch, who followed Portuguese. Then English, who followed the Dutch. And finally, the last people to come to India were French. English and French were the last remaining people, and after a big fight out, English won over the entire French people. Now, there were two routes to enter India, as I said. One was the land route, mainly through the Hindu Kush mountains, and very easy. And this was coming primarily via the Constantinople section. And the other route is the sea route, which nearly except Marathas, every Indian had ignored, which led to Europeans searching for a sea route towards India. And India had very strong commercial interests with the West. Even Mughals used to do extensive trade with the Europeans. The 7th century AD sea route completely fell into the hands of Arabs. And so did the land route. In the age of discovery, the Europeans were searching for a completely new route towards India, and that's what led to the shipping companies coming into India. In approximately 1497, Portuguese King Manuel I sponsored Vasco da Gama to visit India, to come to India. The Portuguese were the first ones to arrive on Indian sea. The reason for the arrival of Portuguese in India was both economic as well as religious. See, Portuguese were especially seeking spices. They wanted especially pepper. as well as they wanted to destroy the monopoly of Arabs and Italians over the trade with the East, or trade with India and the Eastern world. Calicut in those days was like a multicultural city of the world. It was flocked by Muslims, Arab merchants from Aden, Turkey, Persia, Ethiopia, Egypt, you name it. Even Chinese mainland had a factory in Calicut, which was called China Kota. Among the Indians, the Gujarati merchants were the most prominent in the Calicut region. So Calicut will naturally will become the main important choice for the Portuguese to come to India. And they came through the Cape of Good Hope, today what we call South Africa. South Africa. And India, particularly Calicut, was the richest spice port in the world. So if you want to get into India, you need to come to Calicut. Prince Henry, the navigator of Portugal, was so obsessed with finding a sea route to India that he tried, but he failed before he could do. In 1487, Bartolomeu Dias reached the southernmost tip of Africa, today what we call the Cape of Good Hope, or commonly called Cape of Storms, became the first known European to reach the Indian Ocean from the Atlantic. However, it was the fleet of Vasco da Gama 2 years later, on the 20th of May 1498, who landed in Kappa near Calicut. Vasco came to India finally. Vasco da Gama reached the richest spice port in the world. Now, this is pretty much the route which he would have probably taken. Traveling all the way from Portugal towards the Gibraltar, through the Cape of Good Hope, Mozambique, Mogadishu, Calicut, Cochin, Kannur, and then he went back. When Portuguese came to India, in Calicut, the ruler was Zamorin of Calicut, who was very hospitable, and he received the Portuguese with all the hospitality that he could. The result was Vasco was able to return, however, without any concrete result. The reason was the Arabs, who were dominant traders in Calicut at that time, instigated Zamorin not to help the Portuguese or not to consider anything about the Portuguese. The first mission of Vasco da Gama was an utter failure, in up to the extent that it could not produce any specific tangible result for the Portuguese. But it was a great leap of the Portuguese, because the first step is done. They now know how India. The Portuguese now know how to reach India, and now they can rival the Arabs. Remember, from Europe, Venetians were the main traders in Asian spices, which they primarily again bought via Egypt. So Italian-Portuguese rivalry also was important to be broken. The Portuguese were well known for this. What the Portuguese would do is access the Indian ports, access the spices, and sell these spices at very cheap prices across the world, thus breaking the Italian domination in trade. Followed by Vasco was another sailor called Pedro Alvarez Cabral. In 1500, Cabral sailed to India. On his way, he founded Brazil. Pedro even attempted to establish a first Portuguese factory at Calicut. However, again, Cabral fell into conflict with the Arabs. Arabs were dominating the trade system in Calicut. Cabral and Arabs fought with each other. Cabral captured 10 Arab merchant ships, anchored them in harbor, massacred 600 Arabs on board and confiscated the cargo. Famously called the Battle of Calicut, in which Cabral was defeated by Arabs and locals. Cabral started the return voyage. In fact, in reality, Cabral's attempt to physically or militarily eliminate the Arabs from Calicut also failed. He died a humiliated man. Pedro Alvarez Cabral. So two attempts have been done. The Portuguese came through Vasco da Gama, and he was soon followed by Cabral. Both of them did not succeed in getting concrete results on Indian trade. Vasco came back again. This time Vasco revisited India in 1502. Vasco first time came in 1498, then Cabral in 1500, then Vasco in 1502. This time the rulers of Kannur, Cochin and Quilon, or commonly today called Kollam, were very, very sympathetic to Vasco. Kollam, they were sympathetic to Vasco. Vasco placed the demand that all Muslims should be eliminated from the area, but this demand was turned down. In 1503, Vasco attempted to establish a first Portuguese factory. In 1505, he tried to establish the second Portuguese factory in Kannur. See, the Portuguese trading ports or trading factories are commonly called feitorias. These are unfortified trading outposts which also serve as bases for the naval fleet called the armadas. The Portuguese shipping fleets are called armada. Early spice trade mainly comprised of pepper and cinnamon. See, Vasco's attempts to eliminate all Arabs from the Indian trade, however, eventually did succeed. Portuguese ended up setting up a full-fledged trading empire in Indian Ocean. They even controlled the major sea routes between India, Middle East and Southeast Asia. But it was only in 1503 when Francisco de Almeida was appointed the first governor and viceroy of Portuguese India that Portuguese establishment in India really started. Until now, Vasco's two attempts and Pedro Alvarez's attempt was just an attempt to establish business contact. The Portuguese state of India was meant to be the full-fledged governing body of various Portuguese fortresses and colonies overseas, and it was required to function under the viceroy. The Portuguese were not just involved in spice trade, but also in Christian Portuguese state, the spread of Christianity. Francisco Almeida was able to establish factories or fortresses in Cochin, Kannur, Kilwa and Anjadeva. Kochi, Kannur or Kannur, Kilwa and Anjadeva. Eventually, it was under Francisco Almeida that Portuguese control over Indian Ocean dominated. Particularly, Portuguese Governor General had full support of the Portuguese army. He even adopted the Blue Water Policy. The Blue Water Policy is basically about establishing naval supremacy, not acquiring extra territory inland into India. I mean, they don't want to go and occupy interlands of India or inner lands of India. They just wanted to establish an extremely strong navy. Almeida is credited with the construction of Fort Anjadeva, one of the biggest forts, by defeating the then contemporary Bijapur kings, Adil Shahis. In 1508, the Portuguese fleet was attacked by the joint Muslim naval force of Gujarat Sultanate and Mamluk fleet of Egypt at Chaul and Dabul. Almeida's son lost his life in Battle of Chaul. Almeida, however, defeated the joint forces in Battle of Diu, the famous Battle of Diu. See, until now, Portuguese were able to establish themselves only as traders but not as military strength. It was in Battle of Diu that Portuguese were able to establish themselves as military dominant. The Battle of Diu, fought on the February 5th, 1509, also called the Second Battle of Chaul. The First Battle of Chaul, Almeida lost his son. In this second battle, the Portuguese were pitched against the combined fleet of Sultan of Gujarat, Mamluk Burji, Sultanate of Egypt and Zamorin of Calicut. Together, he defeated all of them. After the battle, the Portuguese rapidly occupied all key ports and trading centers on the Indian Ocean like Goa, Ceylon, Malacca, almost. In one way, the Battle of Diu marked the start of European colonialism in India. The Portuguese win also allowed them to completely control the ocean trade on India. Almeida was followed by Afonso de Albuquerque. Afonso was the second governor general. He established headquarters of Portuguese India in Cochin. Goa was the first part of India that was colonized by Europeans but was eventually also the last part. In 1509, Albuquerque occupied Diu, and in 1510, he even seized
Goa occupied and captured Goa from the Sultan of Bijapur. Under Albuquerque, the Portuguese established their domination in the entire Asian coast, from Hormuz in Persian Gulf to Malacca in Malaysia and the Spice Islands of Indonesia. In one or the other way, Portuguese became the most powerful naval entity in India in 1510. Albuquerque even went on to start the first Portuguese mint in the East. He was able to issue gold, silver, and bronze coins, which are based upon local designs. Obviously, with the badges of the Portuguese king. After Goa, many mints were established in Malacca. Malacca is today basically a place in Malaysia. Port Albuquerque was also successful in becoming the cultural ambassador of the Portuguese. I mean, he actually encouraged his staff to marry locals and create a mixed culture of Goan Portuguese. After Albuquerque, many governor generals came, like Soares Albergaria. Albergaria was very famous. He was the third Portuguese governor. He was succeeded by Afonso. He continued the Portuguese war against Arab and Africans. Nino de Cunha, who came in 1529, was the next major governor general. He transferred the capital from Kochi to Goa. So from Albuquerque's period until Nino de Cunha's period, Cochin was the headquarters. From Nino de Cunha, Cochin, say, the headquarters was moved to Goa. Nino de Cunha was even able to bring Mombasa and Mozambique under Portuguese control. In one or the other way, Nino was able to continue the successes of Afonso. In 1534, he even forced Bahadur Shah to sign the Treaty of Bassein, the Gujarat king Bahadur Shah. On the basis of Treaty of Bassein, Bahadur Shah even gave a Bassein, the present day Bassein, Nala Sopara in Mumbai, to the Portuguese. Mughals were able to capture Gujarat and Bahadur Shah, and eventually the Portuguese also kind of lost their authority or lost their charm. It was far too long, because by 1570s, Mughals became the most dominant community or dominant kingdom under Akbar. Their capital remained Goa almost until 1962. Goa, Daman and Diu became the Portuguese center of administration. The viceroys who came after Albuquerque were mostly weak and inefficient. By 1661, Portugal was at war with Spain and needed the support of England. In order to gain the support of England, Portuguese princess Catherine Braganza was married to Charles II of England. And in dowry, Charles received the territories of Bombay. What we today call Bombay was given as dowry to English. The Portuguese administration in India also was becoming very, very inefficient, because the Albuquerque successors were very, very inefficient. And there was also one more challenge, is that the Portuguese government, the Estado de Indias, was fully neglected by their home government. Their salaries were low, they were mostly corrupt. And another biggest challenge for the Portuguese, which none of the other Europeans actually faced, was the religious challenge. The Portuguese were extensively involved in religious constructions or religious conversions. They were very, very involved in this. The Portuguese eventually lost all authority. They drew a very thin line between trade and piracy, which also aroused the hostility of the natives. In 1580, Portugal eventually merged with Spain, which dragged Portugal out of the Spanish Wars of Europe, I mean the famous Spanish Wars of Europe. Portuguese discovered Brazil, which was much more interesting and much more better for them. Eventually, Portuguese power was completely lost, and the Dutch gained all control in India. Dutch became the most important players in India. And see, one of the biggest advantages of Portuguese was, Indian ships were generally very small, while the Portuguese ships were armed and they were huge. The Portuguese warships were very, very huge and they were armed. Indian ships were generally very poor in terms of making. Indian ships were generally armed, not armed, and they were only made with planks made of coir, coconut hair, whereas the Portuguese ships were made of nails. The Portuguese eventually ruled and dominated India for a long period. Let us see the impact. The Portuguese began to propagate Christianity in Malabar region, mainly the ideas of St. Francis Xavier, Father Rudolph, and Father Montserrat, who brought Christian temple. By 1540, nearly all temples of Goa were destroyed, and Orthodox Portuguese type of Christianity dominated the region. Portuguese also brought printing press to India. The Bible also came to be printed in native languages like Kannada and Malayalam. Portuguese missionaries were also one of the earliest to focus on Indian history. Like, for example, Fajeras had even made a deep study of Indus Valley civilization. Portuguese missionary system started the missionary school system. And even day-to-day items like Portuguese introduced into India several crops, fruits, vegetables, which are common today, like potato, sweet potato, tobacco, corn, lady's finger, chili, pineapple, papaya, sapota, lychee, orange, black pepper, cashew, groundnuts, almonds. You can see this, pretty much most of the stuff which we today eat as common foods were actually Portuguese influence in India.
So the Portuguese supremacy on Indian Ocean lasted for just over 100 years. They dominated from 1498 to 1598. Eventually, they lost everything to the Dutch. We will continue the Dutch story and how Dutch established themselves to dominate the Portuguese. See you in the next session.